This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do. All you want to do is ride around
Saturday. Ride, this show that you are about to hear over the next hour is completely unique in the history of this radio program. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. Why is it so unique? Well, two reasons. One, my guest is Jim Masterson, who I interviewed on television. We did a great TV segment with him before interviewing him on radio. Usually it's the other way around. I kind of get to know somebody on radio, and then we do something on television with him. Not so this time. In fact, the TV episode we did with him got a lot of response from the audience, and not all of them do. You know, it's not that they're not all good programs, but some just kind of cause people to want to contact me and learn a little bit more about the subject or interact with me in some way. This was one of those shows where a lot of people said, how do I get in touch with this guy? And they wanted to follow up with him. His name is Jim Masterson, and he is a practitioner of what he calls the Masterson Method of Integrated Equine Performance Bodywork. And he's going to explain right away what that means. Don't let the complexity of the label throw you. It's really a fascinating and remarkably simple thing he does that he's taught himself how to do and that you can learn to do very easily too. Now, I had him do this on my mare Savannah with surprising results. And I have to tell you, I'm a bit of a skeptic about some of these kinds of things because they almost fall into that sort of, they are one of the alternative therapies in medicine, and kind of in that metaphysical realm, I guess, you kind of, it's not part of Western science, and I'm still kind of a science guy, I guess, at heart, but I have seen this work, and that to me is always, that always carries a lot of weight. Second reason that this program today is totally unique is I'm going to read to you an entire chapter from one of my books. My newest book, Human to Horseman, A Journey of Discovery, Growth, and Celebration, which is really the story of the past 11 years of my life, the insights I've gained, the experiences I've had, both good and bad, the great teachers that I've had. All of this is in this book, lots of color pictures. It is just flying off the shelves. People love it. They all tell me the same thing. Once they started it, they could not put it down, and they found so much relevance, even people that aren't horse people, found a lot of relevance to life in general from this book. So got a lot of requests for me to read a little bit of it, kind of give people a sample of what they're getting if they buy the book. And I said, sure, we'll do that. So we started out a few weeks ago with chapter one, which is called A Cold Bleacher. Today I'm going to pick it up with chapter two, which is called Thunder. And this is the name of the first horse from which I really learned very much, and a particularly harrowing experience that I had. That's all coming up at the end of the show. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
For For 60 years, the United States Pony Club has been developing character, leadership, confidence, and a sense of community in youth through a program that teaches the care of horses and ponies, riding, and mounted sports. Red Brand Fence is proud to support these initiatives as the official education sponsor of Pony Club. Through Red Brand's Fence 101 curriculum, Pony Club members can learn correct selection and installation of fence, helping to keep their horses and ponies safe and secure. Learn more by clicking on the Pony Club button at redbrand.com.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the horse show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the horse show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. Today, we're going to talk to Jim Masterson, creator of the Masterson Method of Integrated Equine Performance Bodywork. Jim, how you doing?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Hey, I got to tell you, thanks of all, first of all, for squeezing us in at the end of a long clinic day. You have to be exhausted.
Oh, it's fine. Actually, I'm working on horses today, so... At the show circuit down here in Wellington, Florida.
Now, what do you prefer to do, work with people or work with horses?
Well, I like to break it up. And you know, working on horses, you learn a lot as you work on the horses. And then I love to teach, too. I love to share it. So doing the clinics is a lot of fun.
We're going to kind of dissect this. Now, obviously, your name is Masterson, so I understand Masterson Method. That's your method. But what is integrated equine performance bodywork?
Okay, it's an integrated bodywork because it's not just one type of modality or massage. It actually integrates a lot of different types in it, depending on what the horse's body is asking for. And so I use the word integrated. It's performance bodywork because it's designed to improve performance. There are certain junctions of the horse's body that get kind of tensed up and torqued up during performance. And this is aimed at releasing tension in those junctions so that it'll improve performance.
Now, you mentioned massage. What are some of the other types of things that you integrate in your method?
Well, for example, when you run your hands down the horses, I generally start with the bladder meridian of the horse because it runs along the spine and it's a major meridian. All the other meridians connect to that one. As you run your hand down the bladder meridian, you'll look for responses in the horse's eyes, for example. They're the more subtle responses, a little blink or a twitch of the lips that tells you there's something on a spot that you just went over. So right off the bat, you're using an acupuncture meridian or an acupressure meridian to start the session. So that's one modality. If you find a spot and you hold your hand on it, you might be practicing craniosacral therapy because what you're doing is actually cranial sacral, because that's what's going to get the responses from the horse. So that's another modality that would be involved in it.
Well, you kind of got into this in sort of an unusual way. You didn't go to school to learn how to do this. You didn't really have a mentor, per se, did you?
Well, starting off, I didn't really have a mentor. I was working on show jumpers at horse shows, and I observed some equine massage therapists working on our horses at our barn. And I was fascinated by the responses of the horse, like I was talking about earlier, in the eyes or in the lips, just really subtle responses. I was fascinated by that. And when the horse released tension, I was fascinated by the signs of release, such as licking and chewing or yawning. And so I just started I learned some basics from these therapists, and I just started working on our barn's horses, and I would follow these responses. So I didn't have any formal training. I just was going by what the horse was saying was in its body, where it was holding tension, and by what the horse was displaying in responses when it released this tension.
Now, how did you know that wasn't just some random thing that the horse did?
Well, because I was doing it every day, and I was in an environment where the horses were performing and they were in work, and so they had issues in their body. And so by doing this every day, I would start to see correlations between what I was doing with my hands with the horse and what the horse was doing. And so when that happens over and over and over, you start to see the correlation. You see there's a connection. And if I wasn't sure, that I would just go back over that area. And if I got the same response at the same place, then that would tell me that there was something there. Because the chances of the horse blinking when you go over it once are probably pretty high. The chances of the horse blinking at the same spot when you go over it three or four times are pretty low, you know.
Are you able to attach any particular significance to, I mean, why do they blink when they release tension?
Okay, my theory on this is that the horse has a survival response. It's an instinctive thing that they guard against showing too much pain or showing too much weakness. That's why a horse will keep going and keep going and keep going until it finally goes lame, because it doesn't want to show this lameness or weakness in the herd. If it does, then it's pretty vulnerable. That's the one that the wolf is going to pick out, for example. So when you push hard on an area of the horse's natural response is to guard it. When you go so light in your touch that you bypass that survival response, the horse is going to show you somewhere that there's something there. You're going so light that it has to respond. You know, it has to give you a little twitch of the eye, and that's kind of the first step. And then from there, you can keep going deeper and deeper.
Now, when you get deeper, you kind of get past his guard, if you will, and you start. What's the next type of response after blinking? Say if you're giving a little bit more pressure.
Yeah, let's say if I start going down the horse's neck with my hand, and then I'll get a response or a blink, and then I'll go back over again and I'll get a response. I'll just stay on that area, and I'm just barely holding my hand on the hair of the horse. It's like I call it the air gap level of pressure or heat. If I get a response, I'll just hold my hand there, and I'll just stay there and stay there and stay there, and I'll continue getting little twitches. Then pretty soon the horse will drop his head and start licking and chewing, and that's a sign of release, a responsive release. If there's a bigger release, he'll start yawning, and there's a whole series of the response releases that are larger. Once you get that first release, you can go deeper, harder, and you can start manipulating the horse's head, for example, or his neck, or his leg, or his shoulder, and you can start to get releases of tension deep in these junctions. And you go by the horse's responses. When you get a really huge release, for example, in a major junction, if you step back and you observe the horse will start to yawn repeatedly, sometimes 10, 11, 12 times, and his eyelid will roll back. That tells you that you've just released something major in that area of the horse. Whenever you ask the horse to bend his head or you move his leg, you're doing it in such a way that you're asking the horse to go with you, and you're not like pulling on the leg or pulling on the head. If you start to pull on something, the horse's natural response is to pull away. And if you just ask and ask and ask lightly, then the horse's natural response is to yield to your pressure. So I guess that would be the difference between the horse guarding and the horse yielding.
I'm talking with Jim Masterson about his integrated equine performance bodywork. When we get back, I'll ask him, how long does it take to get some results? I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Hello, I'm Leslie Nielsen, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. Remember, a wet bird never flies at night.
Thank you, Mr. Nielsen. A fine dramatic actor, by the way, in case you didn't know. My guest is Jim Masterson. We're talking about the integrated equine performance bodywork he does. Jim, how long does this take to get some results? What's the longest it's ever taken you to get something back from a horse like that?
You have to kind of throw away the clock, and you're on the horse's time. You can't have an agenda like, oh, there's something here, I'm going to get it out and go after it. You kind of have to ask the horse in a way that he yields to you, and pretty soon his body will release that tension. So if it takes, for example, you're on one spot and you find that the horse has tension there, so you get the horse in a certain position, or for example, with the beginning, you hold your hand there and stay, it might take 5 seconds, or it might take 50 seconds, or it might take, you know, a minute and a half for the horse's body to finally let go and start and release that. And that's when you'll see the responses, the licking and chewing or whatever. If you don't get any responses, that means either there was nothing there, or the horse is still guarding it, and you may be doing what you're doing in a way that the horse is not releasing.
So let's say he does release some tension. How long do the positive benefits of this last?
It depends on the amount of tension or stress that's in an area. So if a horse has an issue in his neck, for example, that's been there for 10 years because of maybe he's had sore front feet, because a lot of problems in the neck and the pole and the shoulders come from front foot pain. Say he had a lifelong front foot pain and he's been working his whole life, that might be very locked up there, all the way up his neck. So you can get a release, and then you can get a release in that area, and then you can go back and you can get another release and another release. It's kind of like peeling the layers of an onion off. So it depends on how restricted that area is, or how embedded it is.
Mm-hmm. But would a horse benefit from a regular treatment like this to sort of maintain this?
It would. If a horse is in regular work, then these issues might keep coming up again, because most of the issues in the body come from another primary source, such as foot pain or from a poor-fitting saddle or some other issue that's causing the horse to compensate in his body in a way that creates tension and restriction in the connective tissue and the muscles. So if the horse has, for example, a sore foot or his conformation, he's got a foot that's, when some horses have a club foot on one front foot and a flat foot on the other, for example. So this is going to cause a constant imbalance in the neck and shoulders. So you just keep clearing that out as the horse works, and then your horse will stay a little more loose and flexible.
And, of course, that has a definite advantage if you're competing with this horse. And I have to tell folks, I didn't include this in your introduction. I probably should have, to give them a little sense of who we're talking to here. Jim was invited to Aachen, Germany in 2006 for the World Equestrian Games, and you were the official provider of this sort of work for the United States Equestrian Team. What was that experience like for you?
Well, it was great. It was for the USET Endurance Team. There are a lot of different teams. There are the dressage teams, there are the jumper teams, there are reining teams. This was the endurance team, and it was a great experience because we went over 2 weeks before the event with the horses, and we stabled in a in a large German local dressage barn, which was kind of interesting in itself. And then we, the riders and the trainers and the chef de keep, the team captain, Valerie Canavy, kept the horses prepared for the event. And during that 2 weeks, I would work on them every day or every other day up until the event. And then during the event, I would work at the breaks during the event, I would work on the horses too.
Well, this endurance, of course, you would think that fatigue is one of the things that you're fighting with those horses. How does this work help them? Does it give them greater staying power?
Well, it does, because when a horse comes in after 7 miles or 10 miles or 15 miles, he's tense. And, of course, he's dehydrated. And so one of the things that the team does is they'll rehydrate the horse and feed the horse. They'll have a farrier there at the vet area to check the horse's feet and shoes. And they'll be giving the horses electrolytes. And they all have their own kind of little recipes. And then while they're doing that, I'll release tension in the neck and shoulders and in the back and in the hind end. Because when the muscles relax, then they... blood circulation comes to the muscles, and then it reoxygenates the muscles, and it helps to flush out the toxins. So it kind of rejuvenates the horse.
A boxer, you know, between rounds, going back to the corner, and he's got his corner team there, and, you know, they're giving him the liquids, and somebody's rubbing his back and stuff. That's you. You're the
exactly
guy giving him the back
rub. You know, everybody comes in, the farrier's in there, the riders get off, and they set the riders down and give them something to drink, and they put it was cold and rainy during that event, so the riders were shivering, and then everybody moves in on the horses and gives them feed and gives them water and rehydrates them, and the farrier's checking them, I'm working on them, so the vets are going over them, and their metabolism has to come down to a certain level within a certain time period for them to pass the vet check in order to do the next leg of the race. So it's kind of like a boxer.
Yeah, well, that's the cool thing about the sport of endurance, and I've always said that because people who don't understand might think that this is kind of an extreme sport and very, very hard on horses. But I have to say that the sport of endurance, I think, has the most built-in safety checks for the welfare of the horse of just about any sport out there. And what you're talking about here with the vet checks is a perfect example of that. If the horse does not meet the standards,
they can't continue.
Yeah, and that it doesn't matter how much work you put into it, folks.
No.
He's out of there. It's all
and
over.
And you can't argue with him either. If the horse shows the slightest a sign of lameness, or if his metabolism doesn't come down, they just pull the horse. So it's monitored pretty closely during the event.
I have to mention that you mentioned Valerie Canavy, and I've had her on. Of course, I think is she a gold medalist endurance rider? She's one of the top in the world.
Yeah, she was a gold medalist twice.
Yeah.
And in 2006, she was the chef de keep of the team.
Well, I have to tell you just a personal anecdote about Valerie. She was on my radio show one time, and we got to talking, and I found out that she grew up in Wichita, Kansas. And I said, well, I grew up in Wichita, Kansas. She said, well, really? What part of town do you live in? I said, you know, the River Lawn area, you know, northwest part. No. Now, what street did you live? And it turned out that we grew up, and we're about the same age. We grew up just a couple blocks from one another.
What do you know?
And I had a paper route for many years when I was a teenager. And I thought for a while, you know, I might have been her paper boy. But then I realized that my route ended just, you know, like one street over from where she lived.
So short of her house.
I've always felt a special connection to Valerie Canavy because of that. And on that little bit of personal trivia, we will take a short break. My guest is Jim Masterson. We're talking about his integrated equine performance bodywork. When we get back, how easy is it for other people to learn? I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order.
Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We're back, everybody. My guest is Jim Masterson, creator of the Masterson Method of Integrated Equine Performance Bodywork. I know it sounds complicated, but it really isn't. I wanted to ask you, you obviously have specialized in this. You're very talented at it. How easily do other people pick it up?
The one reason I teach and do these weekend clinics, and I have a couple of week-long courses for therapists coming up, but the weekend clinics are for horse owners. It's because it's so easy to learn and do. And you follow the responses of the horse. That's what you work with, and that's what tells you where to go next. And on the one hand, you don't have to have huge training in anatomy. You can follow the horse's responses if you just know the basics, and you get that interaction with your horse. You get this communication going. It's a different level of communication than what we're normally used to.
Well, anything that sort of increases the bonding time, any time you are laying your hands on your horse, mm-hmm. with your mind in the right place, I think just enhances the relationship.
You're really focused on every little response of the horse, and the horse, you just kind of get in tune with the horse, and the horse senses that. And once you get some of these releases, and then the endorphins kick in, and the horse's head drops, and his hind end starts to wobble because all this tension is gone, you step back and look for the responses to see what's going on. And then many times the horse will, when he's done shaking it loose or yawning or whatever, he'll step over towards you, you know. He'll put his head right in front of you, okay, I'm ready for some more.
More of that stuff.
Yeah.
You are such a – and I should tell folks that we've actually met before. Mm-hmm. We did a TV segment already on this and had a chance to work with my mare, Savannah, which was she was a pretty good sport about this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to say, you have the most gentle – calm demeanor about you, and I can see why this is so effective with horses. What is your goal? What would you like to see happen with this, with your work, say, in the next 5 years? Is this something you would like to see everybody incorporate into their relationship with their horse?
Oh, yeah, I would, because horses, they can't tell us when they're they're hurting or if they're stuck or they're stiff or whatever, their natural thing is just to keep going, so they can't tell us. And this is, a great way to just start finding out what's going on with the horse. And once you do, the horse relaxes and lets you in. It's very rewarding. And I'd like everybody to do this. And not just because I want to teach seminars, but because it's such a rewarding thing to have happen between you and your horse.
Now, obviously, if you got a performance horse, getting that tension out of there is going to help them perform better. And we talked about the endurance horses; it's going to help with the fatigue issue. What about your regular, just backyard horse, like my horse Savannah that you worked on? What is the benefit to that kind of horse?
Well, I've worked on a lot of just personal backyard horses that had pretty strong issues. The most important area is the pole area of the atlas and the axis and the occiput, the pole of the horse. Horses store a lot of tension in there. They get very jammed up there if their front feet are sore. And also, if a horse has been tied hard and pulled back against a halter, if a horse is reared up and hit its head, there are a lot of horses out there that are just pleasure animals that have a lot of pole problems. Any horse that I've ever worked on or put my hands on that's head shy has had pain and tension in the pole. And we a lot of times attribute it to just behavior. Oh, he's head shy. He doesn't want you touching his head. Well, I think every horse that I've ever worked on that was head shy, it was because they were uncomfortable in the pole.
Now, how do you address that? If you've got a horse that's head shy, obviously you kind of have to do a little bit of training to resolve that issue before you can even get your hands on him.
No. Once you learn how to handle the horse in a way that you bypass his radar to protect himself, and there are a few spots that you learn that have the tension that once you learn those spots, the horse will just often just drop his head. And a horse that's got his head in the air, and then you think, well, this horse is never going to let me work on it. Pretty soon, if you know the right places to touch and how to handle the horse, the first sign of release, they just kind of, they're so tense up there, the contrast is huge. They just drop their head, and then they want you to get more of that pain out. So.
Now, when you were working with Savannah, she didn't have any problems that I knew of. You started kind of on her neck. Well, not kind of on her neck. You started on her neck.
Yeah.
Is that kind of the standard square one that you where you start with every horse?
Yeah. With this method, in the DVD, that's what we start with, the bladder meridian, which starts at the pole and goes down the neck, and it gets the communication going between you and the horse. You start to watch his eyes, and the horse starts to get a sense of what you're doing, that you're not going to hurt it, and it goes down the neck. So the neck is the logical place to start for me.
That is a pretty good place to first touch any horse that you don't yet know.
Yeah.
It's a whole lot better than going right for their head, because almost any horse that doesn't know you is going to be a bit, concerned.
Yeah.
If a stranger comes up and starts putting their hands on the horse's head. But when you come up to the neck, that's kind of a place where you can do some nice gentle rubbing,
right?
And then do exactly what you describe. And again, folks can see this on our TV show when you're actually doing it to Savannah. This is such a light touch. It's almost like the lightest touch you can possibly imagine is the place where you start. And I just picked up this time that I didn't hear the first time we talked was that it's almost like just close enough that they can feel a little heat off of your hand, but there's still a little bit of air between you.
Yeah.
So you haven't even made contact really yet.
Now the horse will just sense your hand there, and then his body will start sending circulation to that area. And you're on an area that has tension because he's told you there is tension. So the body will start sending circulation to that area. And just by staying with your hand there, the circulation will reach a point where it'll release some tension out of that muscle, and that's when the horse will give you the licking and chewing, which is the first level, and show you that something has come loose in there. So it's almost counterintuitive. You think, oh, I better push more now. I'm harder. I'm getting more. But you actually, and you experienced this when you were you had your hands on Savannah during the show, that when you soften is when you got the responses, not when you went harder.
Of course, there's lots of things about handling horses that are counterintuitive to us humans.
Yeah.
And that's one example. When I was talking earlier how you got started on this, you mentioned how you kind of stumbled into it and you started experimenting and you let the horse kind of show you the way by the kind of responses that he was giving you. But one thing that I wanted to bring out was something you mentioned to me on our TV shoot, was that as you went through this, you started realizing, it feels like I'm doing a little bit of massage. Maybe I should investigate. So you kind of then did some research into, for instance, massage, later into the acupressure, craniosacral therapy. So you kind of came into it the back way, but you did eventually educate yourself in these disciplines.
Oh, yes. I consider it a huge advantage that I had no training, because I didn't have any kind of preconception about what was good for the horse or what was the right thing to do. I just went by what the responses I got from the horse, and I followed that. And I would be, I would find a problem in an area, and I'd start working on it, and I'd get huge responses of release, and then I'd think, well, what did I just do? So I'd go get the anatomy book, and I'd, I'm working on the C7-T1 junction here, and I'd study what it looked like, and that's what I was doing. And then I would be working on a horse, and somebody would come by and say, oh, you're doing craniosacral. And I said, yeah, I'm doing craniosacral. And then
now,
craniosacral, what am I doing?
Well, you know, this has happened to me many times where, you know, when you set out to learn something and you don't really have a passion yet for it or any real-world experience with it, and you're just kind of trying to read stuff out of a book or listen to a lecture or something, it's such a hard, painful way to learn. On the other hand, when you dive into something and you start getting some tactile experience with it and your brain starts firing and says, what does this mean, you know? Then you become like a sponge, and then you are really ready to learn, whether it's from another human or, as in your case, you go to books or you go to the internet and you start learning. I found that over and over in my life, that I go into like this super learning mode where I understand it, I retain it, it just becomes part of me, and it's way more effective in my case than any kind of formal training.
Right, you're inspired by it, so it sticks for one, and then you're eager to learn more.
Absolutely. I have one last question for you, Jim, that I'm going to let you go today.
Sure.
How has all of this been accepted by the veterinary community?
It's kind of hot and cold, and it depends on the veterinarian, I think, because there are some vets that I know that have completely given up their traditional practice, and they practice alternative therapies like acupuncture or chiropractic, and they've just given up the traditional. But there are others that are pretty much hardcore, no, that's not going to work, we got to do this, you know, that's a bunch of baloney. And then there's the whole range in between. I think more and more veterinarians are practicing or coming around to the realization that a lot of this stuff works and it helps, you know.
Tell us about the DVD and then I'll let you go.
Equine Massage for Performance Horses, the Masterson Method. I sell it on my website, mastersonmethod.com, all one word. You don't have to have any background in anatomy or massage. You instantly start to get results from the horse. And I also get a lot of people buying it that are massage therapists, and then they contact me and they want to take seminars, and I'm starting to do some week-long courses for therapists. Whatever modality they practice, if they kind of interject this aspect of it, it just helps them get results so much better. So,
well, great.
Yeah.
All righty, sir. Well, thank you so much for squeezing us in at the end of a long, busy day. Now you get to go relax and have some dinner and enjoy a little bit of time.
Thank you. I really appreciate your interest in this. And I'm going up to Ocala on Friday to see Valerie Canavy to work on her horses. So I think I'll buy a local newspaper and take it up, and I'll say Rick said to give this to you, deliver this.
Oh, yeah. Since I was almost her paper boy.
Yeah, you were almost her paper boy. This is long overdue.
All righty. My guest has been Jim Masterson, the Masterson Method of Integrated Equine Performance Bodywork. MastersonMethod.com is his website. Jim, thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Rick.
And coming up in just a few moments, as promised, chapter 2 of my latest book, Human to Horseman. Now, this chapter is called Thunder, which is the name of the first horse that I really learned much from and got hurt pretty badly on.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again. You know, a lot of people think that if you have horses, you have to put up with flies, or you have to install big spray systems or deal with stinky traps or messy tapes. Not true. You can use Spalding Fly Predators, tiny, safe, easy-to-use, and inexpensive beneficial insects that kill flies before they emerge and become a problem. Do like I did and find out more about Spalding Fly Predators. Visit flypredators.net or call 1-888-282-7262. That's 1-888-282-7262.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We do appreciate that, folks. Just let people know about our radio, television shows, our books, our website, the e-blast that comes out every week. They can find out all about it at thehorseshow.com. Now, I promised you a little bit earlier that we would have a sneak peek of my third book, Human to Horseman. We do have the whole book now in audio form. It's 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, cost the very same as the book, so you can the printed book, so you can have it in either form, whatever suits you, $24.95. Now, a few weeks ago, we played chapter 1 from the audiobook that is called A Cold Bleacher, which is basically my introduction to natural horsemanship through an event that I attended with Pat Pirelli. Today, we pick it up with chapter 2, which is called Thunder, which is the name of the first horse from which I really learned very much. Hope you enjoy it.
Chapter 2, Thunder, Discovering the Risk in Riding. After seeing Pat Pirelli's demo, I was eager to begin my personal journey, but I had a pretty basic problem. I didn't own a horse. In anticipation of someday having horses, Diana and I had moved the family into a rambling ranch-style house on the outskirts of Phoenix in an area zoned for horses. Our little acre and a half would someday make a nice place to keep 2 or 3 horses, but that day had not yet come. Raising 3 children and trying to give them the best education we could left little money for buying horses, to say nothing of a truck, trailers, saddles, tack, fencing, barn feed, and veterinary bills. Fortunately, Thunder came into my life about that time.
Thunder was a 12-year-old registered American paint horse gelding, a beautiful sorrel and white Tobiano. He belonged to Phyllis Bechtel, the mother of Diana's talent agent, Ruth Layton. Phyllis loved that horse dearly and had raised him from a foal, doting on him like one of her children. Thunder had received top-notch training and had been shown in both English and Western classes, but Phyllis couldn't ride anymore, and that meant Thunder spent most of his time standing in a box stall at one boarding facility or another. A healthy, well-trained horse in the prime of his life, Thunder needed to be ridden. Phyllis and I met and hit it off immediately. She knew that I was serious about doing right by Thunder and gave me carte blanche to ride him as often as I wanted. Over the next few years, I did just that, exploring the undeveloped desert north of Phoenix countless times on Thunder's back. Usually I rode by myself. I told no one where I was going, and the truth was I never knew where I was going. Thunder and I just headed out into the desert. I had no cell phone, and the only headgear I wore was a rumpled straw cowboy hat. It was with Thunder that I had my first sense of connection with a horse. It was also with Thunder that I had my closest brush with death. It happened one Saturday morning in the summer of 1996 on a trail ride with my buddy El Reitano. Al is an icon, a singer and entertainer from the old school, the school where you wear a tuxedo when you perform and work so hard to show people a good time that your tuxedo is dripping wet at the end of the evening. I had hired him to mimic Frank Sinatra on a jingle for Peter Piper Pizza, and that's when we discovered that we shared a passion for horses as well as music. Al was on his favorite horse, a black 19-year-old Arab named Dark Flame, or Darky, and I was on Thunder. We had a wonderful, laugh-filled ride and caught up on what each of us had been doing. About 9 o'clock, it was getting warm and time to head back to the barn. We came to the narrow highway that separated Thunder's boarding facility from open desert and casually waited for the traffic to clear. We heard the car before we saw it. Approaching from the west was a 50-something four-door Chevy sedan full of teenage boys, music and laughter pouring out the windows. Al and I had been boys once. We knew that just about anything could happen. So we turned our horses toward the car, backed them up a little bit, and went on high alert. As the car rumbled by, the boy riding shotgun yelled something and threw a paper bag at us. It landed under Thunder's feet, and when I didn't hear glass breaking, I was relieved. I figured it was trash, probably hamburger wrappers and cold French fries. Then I saw the smoke. Al got a better look. "Rick," he said in an even voice, "those are firecrackers." About the moment that the thought registered in my brain, the string of black cats began exploding in a noisy chain reaction. Pop, 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 pop. White smoke and bits of paper wafted up from around Thunder's feet. Cars and trucks whizzed by on the highway a few feet away. Thunder threw his head up and gathered himself to take flight. For some reason, I pulled on the left rein only, and instead of trying to hold him back, I let him move in a tight circle above the firecrackers. He couldn't see the source of the sound and the acrid smell, and that was probably a good thing. I sensed that Al was doing something similar with Darky, keeping the horse moving and thinking about placement of his feet. If either horse panicked, we could be in trouble. Finally, after 8 or 10 seconds, the noise ended. The Chevy had long since faded into the distance. "You okay?" I yelled through the smoke as I tightened the circle and brought Thunder to a stop. "Yeah, how about you, cowboy?" he shot back with a grin. "Never better," I replied, and we both started laughing, that kind of nervous laugh you laugh because it's better than crying. We both felt the gravity of what had just happened. Riders have been killed when their horses spooked into traffic. Al and I sat there for a moment, rubbing our horses and letting it all sink in before we crossed the highway and ended our ride. I knew I had been lucky. I knew that if Thunder had been less experienced or less level-headed, if I hadn't supported him in just the right way, if we'd been a few steps closer to the highway, if Al's horse had spooked, if any of 100 factors had been different, the outcome could have been disastrous. As it was, I'd been given a powerful incentive to learn more about what makes horses tick. My survival could depend upon it. Today, the open desert where Al and I rode is filled with expensive homes, but that narrow highway looks much the same, and it still carries the same name, Dynamite Road. Insights for this chapter. Number one, riding can become life-threatening in an instant. Number two, The general public doesn't understand the survival instinct of horses. Number 3. A panicking horse needs to be given something to think about. And number 4. Bending a horse gives the rider more control in an emergency. Here's something for you to try. You'll need a friend for this. Stand with your feet shoulder-width apart, planted firmly on the ground with your knees slightly flexed. Have your friend attempt to pull you off balance. Notice that you have plenty of power to resist when your feet are parallel. Now cross one leg over the other and repeat the exercise. Notice how easily your partner can pull you off balance and how quickly your mind goes to your feet. It's this principle we use with a horse to bring his mind back to thinking rather than reacting. And there you have it, my friends, Chapter 2 of my book, Human to Horseman. The title of the chapter is Thunder. Now, the book is now available in both print form and audio form. You can get it right at my website, thehorseshow.com or ricklamb.com. Either name goes to the same place. You know, thunder was, to me, a teacher. And I had a lot of learning experiences, some of which were kind of painful. But it was a real growth period for me. And I think a lot of people can think back in their own journey and say, you know, this horse helped me learn. I mean, I went through some real growth with that horse. And a friend of mine even has named her horse Profe, which means professor. That is her teacher horse. And I think that's true with an awful lot of people. You know, Thunder was a gelding. And I say was. I don't know if he is still living or not. This was quite a few years ago. But Thunder, gelding. A lot of people prefer geldings. Conventional wisdom is geldings are more even-tempered. They're better for most people, et cetera, et cetera. Female horses tend to be a little bit moodier because of their cycle that they go through every month. I have come to prefer mares. Now, I don't talk about this a lot, and I'm certainly not going to get on a band or a soapbox and say mares are better than geldings. Not at all. It's just I seem to be drawn more to mares, and I don't know why. I can't really explain it in any rational way. It's just something different I feel with a mare and that I get from them. And you know, I've talked to people who prefer mares, and they feel that a mare will sometimes give them more, a mare might have a little more heart, will give them a more sincere, honest try. Now that, I'm sure there's going to be exceptions to that all up and down the line, and I can hear people going, no, that's not true. It's, my experience is completely different. I'm just saying, in my case, mares are kind of the way to go. And we have two beautiful mares. I'm looking at them right now, Candy and Fiedla. And I wouldn't trade him for the world. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.